Hi, I'm Harold Lowe, President and CEO of Lowe FS.
Hi, I'm Greg Lowe, Vice President of Lowe FS. We're pleased to provide this video segment featuring tax strategies for uncertain times, presented by Katz Abosch. We hope you find the information helpful, and if you would like to get more information about Lowe FS, please visit our website at www.lowefs.com or email info@lowefs.com.
There are a lot of changes that are on the horizon, which makes our job as accountants very difficult. It makes your job as taxpayers very difficult. This is the time of the year where you have to be spending your effort doing some year-end tax planning. And probably this year more so than any... You can't hear. Okay, well, I can actually hold it. Probably this year more so than any year in previous history. Year-end tax planning is extremely important because of the changes that are coming into place. But it's also, as Greg said, very uncertain, which makes our job almost impossible. The only thing that we can go by is what is on the books to happen as of right now. But as we all know, Tuesday we have a presidential election, then we have a lame duck Congress, and then we have a new Congress. We haven't seen a whole lot of action in the tax area in the last 4 years. We can almost guarantee there's going to be very little action coming out of a lame duck Congress, regardless of who's going to be elected as president. We may not see any changes in the tax law until sometime next year, and they could be made retroactive to January 1st, 2013, this coming January. So we really have to stay on top of what is it we do. And we as accountants, we as advisors to many of you out here, it's a very difficult situation for us trying to tell you what to do. And it's a very difficult situation for you to plan around. And it doesn't just affect what you do for tax purposes. It affects what you do for financial purposes, for investment purposes as well. So you really have to stay on top of what's happening. And changes can happen at any particular time. So we're going to be talking about the changes in the tax law that are scheduled to go in effect as of January 1st, 2013. So it's right around the corner. We're going to be talking about the things that you need to be at least considering between now and the end of the year. And we're also going to be talking about the things that you need to consider after this year, going into 2013 and beyond. And again, with great uncertainty, we have to all be aware of the fact that this could change at any moment. First, let me apologize for this. This particular slide was prepared over 2 months ago, so it has nothing to do with Hurricane Sandy. So if any of you lost power or had other problems with Hurricane Sandy, I apologize for this, but we really are looking at what we can call a perfect storm, at least in the tax and the financial matter of things. We have the expiration of the Social Security tax cuts that come into play. You may recall that there was a Social Security or a FICA tax holiday that we've had for the last 2 years. The law allowed for a 2% reduction in the employee's share of FICA tax. That expires as of the end of this year, and it's pretty clear that that's not going to be coming back. So right off the bat, for those people that have self-employment income or wages, you're going to see an increase in your taxes right off the bat starting January 1st, 2013. The Affordable Care Act, starting January 1st, 2013, that's going to be the mantra for this. Starting January 1st, 2013, you're going to see some dramatic changes in not only the tax law regarding the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare, but you're also going to see it in other respects, mainly coming into play starting in 2014 with the requirements of employers having to provide health care insurance for all their employees. So that's something to keep in mind. On top of all that, you have the expiration of the Bush tax cuts. Extremely important. These have been in play for a lot of years. They were actually supposed to expire a couple years ago, and the Obama administration went ahead and allowed them to continue for another 2 years, but they expire as of the end of this year. So we're looking January 1st, 2013 for a lot of major changes in the tax law at that point. The one other thing that you don't see in here is that in 2011, there was a budget act that was passed that created approximately $1.2 trillion of budget cuts that fall into play over a 10-year period starting January 1st, 2013. That's going to have a dramatic effect on hundreds of government agencies. And it's going to have a dramatic effect on the economy, one way or the other. You hear, I imagine Mr. Basu will be talking about the possible effects on this, but there are a lot of economists on one side saying that all these things are really what's known as the fiscal cliff when you put them all together. And there's a lot of concern that this is going to create another great recession for us. Then on the other hand, you have people that are saying, well, it's not going to create a recession for us. What it's going to do is help us to get out of our deficit problems. We have a lot of things that are out of control that we have to take control of. I'm really not smart enough to say which one is right. I have no idea. I don't think anybody really has an idea. What's going to happen is going to happen. Hopefully, we're all going to come out of it fine. But we'll have to wait and see. So when you put all these things together, what happens? Missouri blows up. I did have some neat sound effects on this, but the sound is not tied up here. Perfect storm. This is what's going to happen. It's all going to be effective January 1st, 2013, which puts us in a very precarious position in trying to decide how to do some planning. Just to give you an idea, hopefully you'll be able to see this, but trying to give you an idea of what the tax rates are going to change to. That second column on the left shows what the current tax rates are. And the second to the far right column shows what they are scheduled to be based upon current law starting January 1st, 2013. So you can see wages, top rate now, 35%, goes up to 40.5%. Long-term capital gains, 15%. As of January 1st, 2013, that goes up to 23.8%. Qualified dividends, 15% now. That goes up to 43.4% starting January 1st. And so on. So there are a lot of changes here that are right now, under current law, going to go into effect just a couple months down the road. Anything can change, though, between now and then. But this is what's scheduled, and this is what we have to plan for at the moment. The Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, which was passed in 2010, and the Health Care and Education Reconciliation Act, passed the same year, put them together, and you have Obamacare. The rest of my presentation is going to be talking about some of the tax effects that have come through with Obamacare. And then we're going to have Steve Gershman is going to be coming up here and talking about the expiration, the sunsetting of the Bush tax cuts. And then Lori Kirk will be talking about the effects on estate and gift planning. The main item in Obamacare is the 3.8 Medicare surtax that comes into play January 1st. This is a surtax on our net investment income once you reach a certain threshold level of income. I'm going to define a lot of these items, but bottom line, what you need to get out of this, if you're filing a joint return and your adjusted gross income is $250,000 or more, then your investment income may have an additional surtax of 3.8% on it. If your income is less than $250,000 on a joint return, or $200,000 on an individual return, or if you're filing separately, it would be $125,000. If you fall below those thresholds, then this really doesn't concern you. But there are a lot of us sitting in this room, there are a lot of people out in the general public that have incomes of $250,000 on a joint basis, and this is going to have a major impact on not just the taxes they pay, but going forward, how they need to invest their money, what they should be looking at. Just to give you an idea of what's included in that investment income, your taxable interest, dividends, annuity income, passive activity income is considered part of net investment income, and along with that would be any rents. If you have any rental properties, which are considered passive just by definition, if they're throwing off any income, that's going to be subject, assuming you meet those income thresholds, that's going to be subject to this additional Medicare tax. The threshold amounts, as we talked about, for married filing jointly is $250,000. That's all of your incomes, yours and your spouse's income. Other individual taxpayers, $200,000, and if you're married filing separately, it's $125,000. Once you meet those thresholds, then you need to be concerned about this Medicare surtax. Modified adjusted gross income. When I talk about those income thresholds, we're talking about modified adjusted gross income. For the most part, we're talking about your regular adjusted gross income off your tax return. And if you happen to have any foreign earned income, which has been excluded, there's something called the foreign earned income exclusion, you have to add that back. I don't think it affects many of us, but if any of you have any foreign earned income that's being excluded, that has to be added back in determining whether you meet the thresholds or not. In order to plan for this Medicare tax, there are a number of ways you can do it. Number one, you can look to try to reduce your income in such a way that you fall below the threshold. Once you fall below the threshold, then you don't have to concern yourself with this tax. If you're going to meet the threshold no matter what, then what you want to do is to somehow try to reduce your investment income. So there are certain strategies that you can do in order to help reduce your investment income. These are some general things. I wouldn't suggest that you just do this based upon what I'm saying now. I think what you need to do is sit down and talk to your advisors at Lowe FS. You need to talk to whoever it is that handles your taxes, your tax advisor. Determine what's better for you, what's more specific to your needs, because not all of these techniques follow along with everyone. So you really have to look to see if it's beneficial for what you do. But I want to throw these out because they are possibilities for the general public. Municipal bonds. Municipal bonds are not taxable for income tax purposes, so they do not get added into your threshold amount. So therefore, it keeps you below the threshold amount if you already are. It doesn't get factored in there. Also, since they're not taxable, they're not included in your investment income number for net investment income purposes and computing the tax. So there's a savings there. Tax-deferred annuities, the same thing. The income on that is being tax-deferred, so it's not included in your threshold amount, and it's not included in your net investment income. Life insurance, the same thing, investments in life insurance. Rental real estate. Obviously, if you have rental income, net profit on the rental, then that can be an issue. However, a lot of times you buy a rental property, you try to get it to where you're throwing off rental losses, but creating a cash flow. If you have a rental loss, you can use that rental loss to offset your net investment income. Oil and gas investments. A lot of oil and gas partnerships, when you invest in those partnerships, they throw off a lot of deductions in the first year. This is another possible technique. Income tax planning for now. Things that you can do between now and the end of the year. You should consider possibly taking your capital gains now while the rates are low at 15% versus what they could be next year at 43.4%. No, excuse me, 23% for capital gains next year. That this makes a lot of sense to at least be considering. And the wash sale rules don't apply if you have capital gains. So you can create the capital gain this year and turn around and rebuy the same stock almost immediately, and still carry that investment if that's a good thing to do. So you'll pay tax on the capital gain now at the lower rates. You can gift some of your income-producing property or appreciating property to your kids or younger generations. That way you can reduce your having to pick up the income at your level and push the income down to their levels in future years. You can convert your traditional IRAs to Roth IRAs. When you do that, you're creating additional income in the current year, but the income's going to be taxed at the current rates as opposed to waiting until you start taking distributions out of these IRAs and paying them at the higher rates starting next year. There are other things you can do to possibly accelerate income in 2012, whether it's to take additional dividends out of closely held businesses, or to take bonuses this year as opposed to next year. So there are other possible techniques in trying to accelerate whatever income you can in 2012 to get the benefit of the lower rates. You can also sell some bonds that you may have that have accrued interest, so you can capture that accrued interest as income this year, pay the lower tax rates on it this year, and not have to worry about the additional Medicare surtax in future years. Some of the other changes in Obamacare, the threshold, the floor level for medical deductions has been increased from 7.5% to 10% starting next year, January 1st, 2013. Now, for those of us that are age 65 or older by the end of this year, this increase from 7.5% to a 10% floor doesn't occur until 2017. So effectively, you're kind of grandfathered in for another 3 or 4 years. The threshold of 10% doesn't change for alternative minimum tax purposes. That stays at 10%. If you have self-employment income or wages in excess of $200,000 as an individual or $250,000 jointly on a joint return, then your wages or self-employment income is going to be subject to an additional Medicare tax of 0.9%. In the case of a joint return, again, you're going to be looking at your income and your spouse's income. And we're only concerned here with your wages and self-employment income. This increases the total Medicare tax from 1.45% on that income to a 2.35% tax on that income. And it's only on the amount in excess of the threshold. So the first $250,000 on the joint return will be taxed at the 1.45%. Anything over and above that would be taxed at the 2.35%. It only applies to the employee share of the Medicare tax, so it doesn't affect employers. It doesn't increase their tax at all. And in a lot of respects, typically if you have self-employment income and you have to pay self-employment tax, a portion of that tax is deductible on your individual return. However, the portion of the tax relating to this additional surtax of 0.9% is not deductible. So they're increasing the tax but not allowing you to take a portion of that as a deduction. Another change in Obamacare has been that the limit on flexible spending accounts has been reduced from $5,000 to $2,500. Deductible contributions into FSAs, again, effective January 1st, 2013. This amount, this $2,500 amount going forward, will be adjusted for inflation annually. Those are the basic items dealing with Obamacare. But in addition to that, we have some major changes that are occurring because of the Bush tax cut expirations.